Welcome back to the Scriptorium. This is program number 19. And on 18 and 19, we're working on a booklet containing a poem. So let's continue from where we left off last week. We have here the two rectangles making a book opening. Remember, at the end of the last week, the program last week, we took the width of the page and then marked that on the right-hand side of the page, that point here. We took the width of the text and marked that on the right side of the page, and that gave us this point. This is the height of our page. So from the lower left-hand corner of the opening here, we ran a line through that upper right-hand corner for the height of the page, the height of the page here. This, we ran a line through for the width of the page here, and another line through for the width of the text. Now this is a device for designing an entire booklet on the basis of the length of line that you write. That is, you select a poem, you write out the longest line, and when you are writing small enough, and this seems like a reasonable line for your book, you mark the length of that line off over on the right-hand side here. Then that line is extended with the T-square until it intersects this line, which marks the width of the text. Now, where that intersection comes, that will be the width of line on the new book. So then you erect a perpendicular through that intersection, and where that perpendicular cuts through the line extended for width of page, this will be the width of your new page. This will be the height of your new page. You see, these proportions are the same here that they were in here because of our marking them on the right side and extending these lines through. So the next step is to make a new booklet having this height of page, this width of page, this, and it will include this width of text, we hope. So I did that. Now here is the new page with the width of text that was the length of the line, which we did. So we made the new opening, worked the canon on it, and that gives us the top margin, the side margins, and the bottom margin. The next step is to rule the guidelines, and we rule those guidelines with a ruling pen. It looks something like this. And I would recommend that you, unless you want the guidelines to appear in pencil on your booklet, get a mechanical drawing ruling pen like this, and with a pointed pen, you dip it in ink and then fill the pen from the pointed pen. Filling it by putting the pen with the ink down inside that. And you screw this down until you have a very narrow line. Now those lines are marked off with the compasses, and the compasses should be set, as I said before, because then they won't expand or contract. And you set it for the height of the writing that you'll use. Well, what's the next step? Well, I number these lines, you see. Number each of the writing lines. And there are 12 writing lines on the page. So what we do then is to turn to the text. And the poem which I had selected is a little one called The Gates of Paradise by William Blake. And it is, I suppose, important that the poem have these engraved illustrations which Blake supplies, but I like the poem very much, and I like to be able to refer quickly to the marvelous lines in the poem, and it seemed it's a booklet that I'd like to have handy on my bookshelves, so I wouldn't have to look through a big book to find The Gates of Paradise, but could just pull this slim thing out and read these wonderful lines. So, by the way, the Oxford one volume William Blake publishes The Gates of Paradise without the illustration. So there is some precedent for this. Now, In examining this, we decide what we'll have in our book. So we make a dummy. Now the dummy can be any rectangle that you want. It's not important that you have the perfect rectangle. I just take some typing paper and fold it over and then indicate on the dummy what's going to appear there. The pages are numbered. And we can find out by going through first and determining what we want and knowing that we have 12 lines to the page, how many pages we'll need in the finished book. So the Gates of Paradise here will be the first page, the title page. Now we'll have fly leaves, extra leaves out here, but for the sake of working, we go right to the pages where we'll be writing. On the verso of the title page, we'll have a blank. There's nothing there at all. Then the caption on the illustration, the first one, I want to include. It's, what is man, a question. The sun's light when he unfolds it depends on the organ that beholds it. A very important opening for the thing, and that will be on page 3 by itself. The what is man, the sun's light depends on the organ, and so on. Now let's turn, and we find that the prologue comes next. And the prologue conveniently turns out to be just 12 lines in length. Now we count the prologue here as a line. We count the what is called the white line here as a line. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So that comes out just perfectly. So on page on that page, we have the prologue and the verses that go with it. Following that is the last couplet, and it's, I have said to the worm, thou art my mother and my sister. And that's important to the meaning of the poem, so that will be page 5. And I'm marking lightly in pencil on this old beat-up copy of Blake that will be page 5. Now page 6, I decided, will be the keys plus a white line plus the caterpillar on the leaf reminds thee of thy mother's grief. So I indicate that on the dummy here for page 6. So I'll know exactly what will be on the page 6. The of the gates makes page 7, and the 12 lines come down to here. So I mark down of the gates on the dummy, and then the last line, the 12th line, counting the title and the white line as a line, as lines. Then comes page 8, beginning here, ending here. Page 9 starts here and ends down here. 10 runs through. But it leaves 2 lines left over for page 11. So I indicate the 2 lines here by just starting them, weaving in dreams and weeping. So now I know what goes on each page. To the accuser is the powerful part of the poem, and it turns out to be 12 lines. There's 2 lines for the little title to it, and then a white line, and then 4 white lines, 4 more, coming to 12 altogether. So then page 13 would be blank, page 14 would be the colophon. Now what's a colophon? Old books, old handmade books and printed books had colophons, and it says this was written out for such and such a person, in case you're giving it to somebody, by so-and-so, such and such a place, then you put the date on it. Sometimes they had Laos Deo or Praise God, a long book and they get tired and are awfully glad that it's over with. Then these 2 pages, 15 and 16, are blanks. Nothing on them at all. The next step then would be to cut pages and so on. But before we do that, let's take a breather and visit some wonderful young ladies, some of them with white hair, out at the Salvation Army class in Italic handwriting.
In this class, I've stayed with it because they're the most fascinating people I've ever met. This is one of the friendliest groups of people and the most industrious that I think I've ever worked with.
Well, I've always enjoyed beautiful penmanship. I think perhaps because my father was a penmanship teacher, he did it as a sort of moonlighting, as they call it today. And about 4 or 5 years ago, I began writing haiku. And I thought that haiku and calligraphy would go beautifully together. So one would enhance the other. So then I joined this class. And I took 2 or 3 courses with Mary Unger, I should say. And I came back to visit today.
I might say that I seen Dr. Reynolds on the television one Thursday, and to me it was completely fascinating. And I thought if I could only do something like that, I would be so happy. And I think the fact that they teach the youngsters at school this now is real interesting. And they do such beautiful work, and they're just little children, you know.
I've always been interested in beautiful writing and nice printing, and I also am interested in genealogy, and I want to learn this real well so I make my records neat.
I might say that our teacher, Mary Unger, has been so wonderful to us that that's half of it too, because we're so happy that she can teach us.
We just couldn't pass up the opportunity to have a teacher come to this Rose Center, which is very pleasant, and learn really how to do it correctly. That's the thing. See, we try different things. We have the time at home now that we're retired, and this is something you can practice at home, just like your Chinese painting and embroidering, and it's just been wonderful, as besides enjoying the class and everybody in it.
Yeah.
You can do so many things with it. You can make your Christmas cards and bookmarks and greeting cards of any kind. I found that it's very practical.
Well, that's a delightful visit to see these people and their enthusiasm. We have the dummy worked out. Now we know what will go on the pages, so all we need now are the pages. So cut out pages which are exactly the size of this new booklet. And I'll cut them out and then number them. These are numbered. See, these are exactly the size. I put the two sheets for fly leaves in here, and this will be one. So this page then is placed, by the way, these green lines show up very prominently on this diagram, and you might feel that that would be distracting. Well, it would be. I wouldn't want to work with those on there. But remember, I ask that you do the diagrams with a hard pencil, say a 7H or a 9H pencil. You would be able to see these lines, but they wouldn't show the way they do here on your TV screen. I use color and a rather wide stroke here so that it would show up adequately. No, all you'd see would be the outline and the guidelines. So we put this page over the guidelines, put it down with tape, and then you can see the lines through there. So the first thing is to write the gates of paradise using those guidelines. Now, what's the next thing? This is blank. But don't start the page 3 over here, because this is page 11, you'll notice. And it's very easy to get confused unless you have a dummy. So you have to turn to page 3 according to the dummy and write what is man and so on. So then we'll look on our pages here, find page 3, and put that down and write the three lines, 4 counting the white line. And the white line is one of the writing lines on your page. And we write that in and then get ready for page 4. Now, page 4, of course, is the verso of that recto page, so that goes over here. And you write page 4 there. And when you finish that, you have to find the sheet that has page 5 on it, and that is a recto page. And you put that down and go on with number 5. I have said to the worm, and so on. Number 6, by reference to the dummy, we see is the keys of the gates. So we write those four lines, one line title, white line, two lines text, and then go to number seven, and seven happens to be the opposite side here because this is the center of our little booklet. And you go on that way using the dummy to be sure that you don't write on the long, wrong line. Now, suppose you make a mistake. Well, it's better not to make a mistake, and I'll show you how to avoid making a mistake. It's no absolute guarantee that you're not going to make a mistake, but this is almost foolproof. I write the whole thing twice, you see. Now, here is the first line where the text of the poem actually begins. Mutual forgiveness of each vice, such are the gates of paradise, and so on. Well, I write all those lines out, and write them out not necessarily making the letters perfect, but being sure that the spacing is right, because it's the spacing that's the important part of this. Now, I would proofread this carefully. Better have a member of the family or some friend proofread it to be sure I haven't made any mistakes in spelling, to be sure I haven't left anything out. Now, look, we put this new sheet down and tear off the line. Place it exactly over a previous line. Fasten it down with drafting tape. You'll notice that the M begins here right at the margin. So now on this new paper, which will be under here, but I want you to see the guidelines, I will write mutual forgiveness of each vice, just copying on this sheet what is above. In that way, if I feel I'm in a hurry and I think this E is the final E, I don't put down two S's, but I put the N down and then go on and finish the word. You'd be amazed how easy it is to skip letters when you're writing, thinking you're farther along, and omit letters. Then this happens to come out just the right length. After that ink is dry, I tear off the next line and place it down over the line of dried ink, and then beneath it, I write out on the paper the next line. So that there's no way that way of having these lines, there's no way of, unless you get terribly confused and are awfully tired, there's no way of making a mistake. This is probably the safest way of all. Or you might write it out completely and use a light table, that is a table that has glass in it, and a light behind the glass, and then you lay a sheet of paper over that whole thing with the guidelines on the sheet of paper, and write sort of going over what is directly beneath. But I prefer this way. It letters your floor up with a lot of those short lines. Now, after that is all done, these are put together. The next step would be sewing these so that your booklet wouldn't keep falling apart like this. Now, the sewing is a very simple task. You find the center here, punch a hole in it, you find the midpoint between this and the head of the book, put a hole in here, find the midpoint between the center and the foot of the book, put a hole in there, and then with thread, you sew it. Now, this is the way the design will appear. Here's our book. You go, if you want the knot on the outside, you go in here with the needle and thread. Over here, see, this is on the inside now, on the gutter. And you come down in here, over here to the left, to the midpoint, go through there, come back here, and then down through that center hole. And then you pull the threads up tight and tie them. Now, if you want the knot to appear on the inside of the book, in the gutter, then the needle goes in on the top, around, and so on. And the knot will be on the inside. Here, the knot will be on the outside of the book in here. The next step is to cut cover stock. Now, in the art supply stores, this is called art paper, and you can get quite a variety of very nice colors. So you cut that so that it will be the size of the book with good flaps, because these flaps folding over help keep the thing together, and they look nice. You may want extra fly leaves, but they'll look very nice when the thing is put together, and you open it up. In order to put the cover on, what I do is put a piece of newspaper down on the writing desk, lay this down on the newspaper, and with a piece of scrap paper over it, just a large sheet of scrap paper, go into about a quarter of an inch to the edge, and then with library paste, paste along that narrow edge. Then turn it over and repeat the process on the other side, pasting in here. Then you put it into the cover stock and fold these in. The knot, you see, will now be, there'll be paste on either side of that knot. Well, what you need now is to dry it, but I would put it under pressure. I would lay heavy books on it. If you have a screw press, fine. You don't know the old kind of iron press that was used in copying letters. But if you don't have one of those, put some stiffening material, board or whatnot, along this edge, and then pile heavy dictionaries. If you have one of these huge family Bibles, pile that on. Put on anything you have that will give weight to this to hold it down, and by next morning, it should be dry. Now, the title might be put directly on the cover here in a light ink or dark ink to contrast with this rather dark green stock. You can cut out a contrasting piece of paper, a little rectangle, say in tan or brown, and then write the title on that in black ink. And that can be put down with library paste before you put the thing under pressure. It's rather nice to have a title on the cover so that when you pick the book up, you won't have to look into it to be sure whether you have it upside down or not. You can turn it. This is the cover. Then you know that you can read it as you go through. Now, here's a very important consideration. Suppose you have a number of poems in your book. Be certain that they all begin right here on this top writing line. If it's a short poem, don't think that it will do to start it down here just above the center of the page, because if you have one poem up here and then one down here, the result is very messy. The ancient shop practice, the tradition in hand-produced books and in printed books, is to start every line up here on the top line. So you don't distribute these throughout in some uneven way, but begin the same distance from the top all the time. And use the left-hand margin. If the poem is short and it doesn't go out to the right-hand margin, well, that's perfectly all right. Here, this begins at the left-hand margin. If it doesn't go clear out to the right-hand margin, that's all right, too. There's no necessity of touching the margins here, as there might be in case you were producing a broadside. And we might talk about that the next time. Well, if you have any questions about working this diagram, I hope you can see the program again, read the text, and all the problems, I think, will disappear if you study the text very carefully and go through step by step and do it yourself four or five times. And if you still have a problem, then find someone who's some teacher and find out what's wrong. Or if no teacher's available, send your copy to me. Send what you've done, and I'll try to find out what is wrong. Sometimes a person will work without using the full opening of the page, and he won't make these measurements accurately on the right side. But I guarantee that if you work patiently, being patient with yourself, that you're likely to find out that you can do it. because it's not nearly as hard as it looks. Some experience will get you going on it. Well, let's start the first page then, if I have the right pens here. No, before doing that though, the small caps are extremely valuable. I mentioned the small caps and showed one line of them in my text, but look at this, please. This is a book written by one of my ex-students, Jacqueline Svarin, called Written Letters. She has 22 alphabets in here. It's a beautiful, beautiful book, and I recommend the book highly to you. The small caps which she has here are exquisite. They're only 3 pen widths high, and they would be very handy in your book work. You can see how they look together here. They'd make a marvelous title page, and it is customary to put the title page in capital letters. Well, thank you.